And now I would like to give opportunity to you, our participants, to ask your questions. I see that some questions are already being put. Thank you. I will read some questions from Mr. Mahmoud Ramazani. Hi, I do want to appreciate for this program. It's very useful. I hope we can have more program like this to increase educational knowledge. We will definitely try to do so. I have a few questions if you do not mind. First question is Carniola queen for Iranian nature? I think this question will best be answered by Dr. Kozmus.
Yeah, hello.
Yes, we hear you.
It's very hard to answer to this question. If you are allowed, maybe the best way it is that you import some queens and to check if this Carnica queen is also appropriate for your climate and pasture conditions. We usually use this approach if some beekeepers from new country would like to use Carnica. And in the beginning, it's very hard to say anything, but after then, it's possible to based on that experience, to have better question for future imports of bees. Otherwise, these queens are very good also for cold climates, so beekeepers from more northern hemisphere, they inform us that queens are very good also in Siberian area, also in some countries in Scandinavia, but I do not have information how these queens will be good for your climate and pasture conditions.
Thank you, Dr. Kozmus. Then next question is, how do you treat your bees for varroa mites? Maybe Dr. Žvokelj or Dr. Kozmus as well. Dr. Žvokelj.
Okay. yes. We have quite a lot of medicines that are registered, but you know it really depends. So there are two main. Ways how you treat your bees. One is that you use the chemicals in the base of Kumafos, Amitraz, and Flumetrin. So these are three chemical substances that are allowed in Slovenia and you can use them. But this is not for organic or, organic beekeeping. So another thing, which is another way, is that you use organic organic acids or etheric oils, you know, base of formic acid, oxalic acid, and thymol. So these are other three substances. But in that case, you also need in Slovenia to do some technology methods, also like queen caging, and so on. So these are the main things we use. Also in Slovenia, it's regulated that every beekeeper must treat the colonies against varroa two times per year. This is also quite interesting because you will not find this elsewhere. Why is this in Slovenia? Just because I mentioned the density of the colonies in Slovenia. So one beekeeper can actually treat against varroa and be very successful, and then he has a neighbor who just forgot or is not so good beekeeper or doesn't have time. And you know, the problem is that he's the varroa around 50 meters around one beekeeping yard, beekeeping house, can easily be in the autumn time where there are a lot of robberies just because of low purer pastures or no food in the environment, can be easily transmitted from one apiary to another. That's why we have now regulated that every beekeeper must do something against varroa two times per year. And this the question is quite wide how to do it, but so we have just these two main opportunities, on organic way or using amitraz, kumafos or flumetrine.
Thank you, Dr. Žvokelj. The next question is, do you have artificial insemination training programs for international demands? Who would like to answer this question?
If I may, I will answer.
I would yes, like Dr. Kozmus.
Yeah, thank you. I would like to inform that we do have knowledge about artificial insemination, but usually we don't need it, because here in our country it is present only our subspecies Apis mellifera carnica. So this artificial insemination, it is not very well or very widespread to the country. So therefore we do not have this training program for the international demands.
Thank you, Dr. Kozmus. The next question is, do you have small hive beetle problem? If not, how close they are to your country?
Okay, thank you. So we don't have it. It is in Calabria, in Italy. So this is around, maybe Peter, could you help me with kilometers?
1,000.
1,000 kilometers, thank you. So it's we are not so afraid. We are afraid, but actually we know the problem for the small hive beetle is still the winter. So it will be, when we notice it, it's very important we do much effort how to do our first step, first week, because it will help the problem in the winter in Slovenia. So we are quite optimistic, even if we are quite nervous about it, just because of the density, you know. So
thank you, Dr. Žvokelj. And the final question from Mr. Ramazani is, I hope I will just read it as it is put here. Susan Kobe has new world Carniolan. What is the difference with your breed or your breeder?
Yes, I will answer if I may. We know.
Yes, Susan. Please, Dr.
Yes, thank you. We know Susan Kobe very well. She was also in Slovenia many times, and she collects drone semen. For that, the same purpose, to produce this new world Carniolan. Actually, I don't have information how this Carniolan is different as it is ours. Probably it's not the same, but it's very hard to answer in which characteristics this Carniolan subspecies is different in comparison to our.
Thank you, Dr. Kozmus. And now I would like to invite Ms. Pega Valizade to post her question. Ms. Valizade, are you here with us?
Hello, yes. Can you hear me well?
Yes, we hear you well.
Okay, thank you very much. Hello to everyone. And first of all, I would like to appreciate Madam Ambassador, all the organizers, and of course the invited speakers for such a good meeting. It has been amazing. In 1 hour and something, we learned already a lot on beekeeping and all research around it, and I personally feel very happy about this meeting. So thank you all very much for this. I do have several questions and comments from different speakers, and some of them sharing. Maybe I would start with this question that do you have the migratory system of beekeeping in Slovenia?
Yes, if I may answer this
yes,
question.
Yes.
Yeah, we have quite a lot of migratory beekeepers who move their beehives from one location to the another. So they must to fill special recommendations, they must check if the area where they would like to move their bees, that they are not closed because of different diseases. And we are also have very good observation service for nectar in Slovenia. This means that we have quite big net of bee colonies around Slovenia, which are with beehives on the scales. So each evening we get data where in Slovenia is the best pasture, what's the best pasture in one day. So based on this information, all the beekeepers who are moving their beehives from one location to the another, they can choose to which location they will move their beehives. And also after the one pasture is ends, it's very easy to check with this system when the pasture is ends, and then the beekeepers get information that it is time to harvest honey.
Nice. So is that the more common way, or do you have any idea roughly like if people would mostly prefer to move them, or it's more stable?
The usually beekeepers are hobby beekeepers. They have bee colonies just in one place, in apiary. Just around 10 or 15% of beekeepers are moving their beehives from one location to the another.
10-15%, you said, right?
Yes.
Okay. And in the breeding, actually, my next question is from yourself as well. At your breeding program, you do work with beekeepers for producing queens. Approximately, may I ask, how many beekeepers do you work with each year?
13.
13. Okay. So with 13 beekeepers, you're producing around 42,000 queens per year.
Yes.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. My next comment actually is also to you. So while I already have you on the board, maybe I would start with that as well, or continue with that. Just to introduce myself, I'm faculty member at Animal Science Research Institute Honeybee Research Department in Iran. And I'm happy that I've been honored that we met before at Apimondia in person. And actually, not long ago, just very recently, I also had a discussion, a very nice talk with Madam Ambassador regarding what we do. And as you already know, we had a chat before that we do have a breeding program on Apis mellifera meda, the Iranian honeybee, here in Iran as well. And I just recently joined it, but it has been going on for 23 years now. Considering that there has been a question asking if Carnica would be appropriate for Iran, I would like to hear your comments on it, considering that this exists. And there are, actually, I do have several of them with me right now, and there are a lot more than this. Proofs like scientific articles proving that, unlike what some people without enough proof are claiming that it's already gone and it doesn't exist, it shows very clearly that even 2020 paper, like just last year, is showing clearly that Iranian honeybee exists in Iran. So considering that, I would like to hear your comments, what you think in terms of using our own or to get Carnica from elsewhere.
Thank you for your question. In your case, if are still possibility to find your domestic subspecies, I will try to preserve this subspecies. I will be very careful with importing any other subspecies, because after you are import, then you know that it starts mixing with domestic subspecies, and in many countries after that they recognize. They found out that these mixing bees in the air are worse than domestic one. So I'm working with different beekeepers association in the world. Also right now I'm invited for 3 months to go to the Iran, to the Saudi Arabian, because over there they also each year they are import more than 1.5 million bee colonies from Egypt. And because of that importation, they are probably lost their own bee colonies, domestic.
There's also Yemenica, maybe, no?
Excuse me?
Is there native bee Yemenica? You said in...
Yes, probably. But now they would like to found it and also to spread it. But after you are importing so many bee colonies from other area, other countries, it's very hard to conserve domestic subspecies. So it is much better to conserve domestic one before you start to importing the other ones. So we can learn here from some other examples from other countries and maybe not do the same mistakes as it was done in other countries.
Exactly. I'm very, very glad to hear that from you, such an expert working on Carnica. So it's really amazing to hear that. And considering that, interestingly, the breeding program in Iran also works on the main three traits are exactly the same as yours. The calmness, the swarming, and honey production. So it's interesting that the three are going the same. Thank you very much for the comment. Also, I just wanted to add a couple of more comments very briefly that it has been amazing to hear that I can't pronounce her last name properly, but Lucia, I think. Doctor, is that Lucia? Am I pronouncing her first name at least correct?
Lucia.
Sorry, my apologies, really sorry. It has been amazing to hear you, all the comments and all the speakers, but specifically I was very excited to hear that university, you are having some people as a staff to go around and to inspect and to help out beekeepers. It's amazing. I think that if we could follow the same way, that not only that perhaps our Ministry of Agriculture needs to go with that way to have more and more people as a staff specialized in this area, but also university is putting financial facilities for this, which is amazing, and I'm really happy about it. Another issue that it was exciting to hear is the central registration for apiaries, which that one also, I think that it would be amazing if we could also follow the same way and have that in Iran as well. So very nice, and thank you very much all for all the talks and all the information, and thank you again, Madam Ambassador, for inviting me, and also for all the very good information. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your questions. We now have Mr. Alireza Arab, who has raised his hand. So, Mr. Arab, if you are here.
Yes,
thank you. Please. Yes, we can hear you.
Yes. Thank you for a nice meeting. Thank you for a nice meeting. My question is about free treatment beekeeping in Slovenia and maybe some other European countries. I know you have a good experience about this issue in Slovenia and some other European countries. One of the big problems in our country is that backyard beekeepers and part-time beekeepers use hard acaricide more than standard levels. Do you have any suggestion about this issue, free treatment, beekeeping methods and techniques, and or some biotechnical methods about this issue?
Thank you. Actually, we have quite the same problems in Slovenia, but maybe it's quite a big issue. We are trying to put out, and also on our web page is the program. Each year we give a program. We have some beekeeping yards to start again. I'm sorry. So we have some beekeeping houses in 3 to 8 parts of the Slovenia. When we get data of the number of varroa at that time, and we on our web page, we actually, when we count and we do the examination and the diagnostic test, we put then the results and also the recommendations for how to treat the bees in next month or next 2 months, depends on the season. And these recommendations are done for the beekeepers who only use the treatment that is allowed also for organic beekeeping, and also for the what to do in a case where the number of varroa is too high and they need to do something immediately, like they can just use kumafos in this way, or if they don't want, they just had to destroy all the brood and so on. So there are many different ways what to do. But what we are trying now is that, yes, we put these programs on the our webpage. And of what if I understood correctly, what I also told at the end, that we have some regulatives, and so beekeepers must do something against varroa twice a year. So inspectors go around and could check this in a diary. It's a veterinary diary, it's a veterinary book, and each beekeeper must write down everything about treatment in his bee colonies, and inspectors go around and check about this. This is not to be such regulatory country, but just because there's so high density and it's so important that all beekeepers respect some rules, respect also the bees, because they are the animals, and the treatment is actually in our country is necessary. We cannot allow to have resistant bees or something like in some American countries, they can do some programs on this, but in Slovenia the density and the land is too small. I hope you answered you, if I understood correctly.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Žvokelj. So we now have 3 more questions in chat and 1 more raised hand. And I think this will be then enough for this evening, but hopefully the conversation will continue. So the first question is by, as mentioned before, Dr. Sharam Dargostar. Thank you to the Slovenian ambassador for arranging this meeting, and thanks to all the lecturers. The question is, how the beekeepers can produce resistant bees against disease without depending on any research institute? I mean, is it possible to select the best queens by themselves? Who would like to answer this?
I will try to answer. I think that it is very hard to select queens which will be without or to be resistant against diseases. We are trying, but I think that it is probably not possible. Without help of the institution, I think that this help is, or this work is even harder. This is my opinion. Maybe also Lucia will add some her comments.
Yes, thank you. I would really like to give some comments on this topic, just because we are also working in some other countries where they have some native bees. So they didn't import or mix bees with other races. It's very important that defense of the bee colony is very, very, strongly connected to the environment. And when actually we must be honest that when beekeepers, when we start to do something with bees, bring them nearer to our homes, have them in bigger density, put maybe in the not right hives for them, the the worst things we can do is on their defense against diseases. So I'm not in Europe or in our country, I just cannot be optimistic in the programs about on this topic, to have resistant bees in a short way. I think it is possible, and we can see that in some countries where there is no intensive beekeeping. We can see that even the varroa is there present, bees just had enough time to develop because there was not so big pressure on them in a way of honey yield and so on. They have this behavior and they can manage it. But as soon as we want to have bigger colonies, to have more honey, of course, this is the not so good side effect, is the defense. So it's very important, if you have some places in your country when you have still the native bee, it's very important the program, how to preserve these parts of the country. This is just my point of view, because when you go so in this way, so in intensive beekeeping, you actually lose this mechanism. But I think there is a one thing which can, if but in a case of national program or just a part of the national program, you can do some moves on in a case, but together with technology, the bee density, everyone, all the institutions that are incorporated, they must cooperate together to get the result, but it must be really a strong national program on that. Just my opinion.
Thank you, Dr. Žvokelj. We now go to question by Mr. Reza Bideski. First of all, thank you for inviting me to this conference. It's my pleasure. Pleasure is ours as well. I had a study about beekeeping in different countries. About Slovenia, I realized Slovenia is the only European Union member state to have protected its native bee. Slovenia has common border with other countries and bees can fly. And something like smuggling, how did you protect your native breed?
Thank you for this question. Yes, this is a problem. First of all, I think that it was in 2005 when we joined the European Union, and we put a lot of effort to convince European Union that we would like to have closed air for our subspecies. And we were very glad that European Union allowed us to have this exception. So yes, we are the only country in European Union where it's prohibited to use any other subspecies except our autochthonous Apis mellifera carnica. So yes, sometimes our beekeepers also think that some other subspecies is better than ours. And yes, smuggling bee colonies or queens through the border, it is very easy. And we know that it is very hard to prevent this in 100% sure, but we try to do other work. We try to convince beekeepers that beekeeping with our Apis mellifera carnica is the best way, because it is the best adapted subspecies for our conditions. We know that our carnica is not just very calm, not aggressive. It is also very good in forest, in collecting forest honey. And Slovenia is very widely covered with forest. We have around 60% of the total area covered by forest. So we need subspecies which is good in collecting forest honey. And also other very good characteristics has carnica. So we are glad that we don't have a lot of beekeepers who are trying to have another subspecies. But we have problem with the west part of Slovenia, where it is connected our subspecies with Italian subspecies, Apis mellifera carnica. Over there is their natural area of mixing. So in that area is not pure carnica and not pure Italian, but it is some buffer zone. and we are informing beekeepers over there and also beekeepers in other parts of Slovenia to be careful when they move bees to pasture in that part of Slovenia, and even to be more careful when they are buying bee colonies. Especially, we not recommend to buy bee colonies in the west part of the country and then move them to the center of Slovenia or in the east part. So we are doing a lot of information. We do it not just promotion. We just would like to convince beekeepers to take care for our Apis mellifera carnica, because different institutions like Slovenian Beekeeper Association or Agriculture Institute or National Veterinary Institute, we don't have chance to do anything in conservation. The biggest work is on the beekeepers. We can just suggest them what is the best way, and then we hope that we convince them at least 99% of the beekeepers, and if we will convince 99, I think that we succeed, but it is not possible to convince all of them.
Thank you, Dr. Kozmus. I believe this answers the question. Now we have one last question from Mr. Ramazani, who asks, Apis mellifera is not native of USA. Do you think losing beehives has anything to do with importing so many different queens? Mm-hmm. Who would like to try with this?
It's hard to say. Probably I will try, and then Lucia will add some her comments. I think that in America there are mostly professional beekeepers. They are doing with bees in other way as hobby beekeepers, not to go too much in details. And they're moving their bees for many thousand kilometers, not just 100 kilometers. And this is the biggest distance which our beekeepers are doing in our country, because our country is not so big. I think that part of the problem could be the way how they beekeep. Probably the one reason is also pesticides, and also maybe some reason it is that bees are not native in the United States America.
Thank you, Dr. Kozmus. Now I see that we have additional two questions, so I see no reason why not to ask them, since I'm happy that the debate is ongoing. So the first question is from Mr. Mahdi Akhavan Mogadam, who is also our embassy's resident beekeeper and tends our apiaries in the embassy's garden. So he also thanks for a very good webinar, and his first question is, in the last 3 weeks we have experienced heavy colony losses in the north of country. Some specialists believe that it is related to Nosema serranae. Do you have Nosema serranae in Slovenia? If yes, what do you do for treating it?
Yeah, thank you. I think this will be a question for me. We have Nosema serranae. We don't have Nosema apis anymore, which is more in the north. What I know from Nosema serranae is that in Slovenia, from our experience, and we do quite a lot of samples, it is a problem where, like, it's not the only problem when the colony dies and we say the first reason is Nosema serranae. This is not our experience in Slovenia, but we know that this is the problem in the more warm climates, like in Spain, in Portugal, in France. They have cases like this, that Nosema serranae can be a cause of colony loss. What we have problems with Nosema serranae is just a big stress, like it was the last year, because there was quite bad weather in May and June, And beekeepers had to feed bees a lot with sugars. And what's happening now that the what I'm seeing in the field is that there is a quite big loss of bees. So the bees just dies before the spring. They die earlier as they should, and the colonies are quite weak. And we suspect that this is really because of the because we have the results of the lab, and it's really a huge infection, a lot of Nosema sirani in there. But just the colonies don't just die because of this. I think the problem Nosema sirani just itself is not the case in our country, but cannot be sure for yours. In our country, most of the colony losses we have during the winter is varroa. Is all the treatment was too hard with too big dose and too much treatment, or more often is it was too late. And the damage on the bees is so huge that the bees cannot overwinter.
Thank you, Dr. Žvokelj. Then next question by Magdi could probably be answered by Ms. Ferfila. Do you offer a PhD program in bee genetics and breeding in Slovenia? And is it possible to apply for that?
Yes, I checked by myself. We don't offer bee genetics and breeding PhD program in Slovenia. According to my knowledge, perhaps if Ms. Vokel or Mr. Peter would have different information, let's give space to them. But according to my knowledge, no.
Dr. Kozmus,
I think this is also a question for some professors here in Slovenia. We do have some professors who are working also on beekeeping field, and maybe we can share with you those emails, and maybe it's possible to direct ask them and to check if it's any possibility.
Thank you. Yeah, that would be very helpful. And we have one last question by I'm sorry for mispronouncing this, Behtesh Danadeh from the Pishru Zaborandaran magazine. And that is, what nutritional advice do you have for strengthening the bee population inside the hive?
I think that natural nutrition is the best. This we are promoting here in Slovenia, but I know that each year we have more and more products in the market. Actually, I do not have any experience or knowledge or investigation which one to suggest. Maybe Lucia, do you have some?
Well, maybe I can just help you here, because I also forgot to answer one part of the question before, what we can do about nosemosis. So in Slovenia, there is also in EU, this is prohibited to use any antibiotics. And I think it's important, yes, to add this. So we know with antibiotics, there's more problems than solutions. So you know that North America has big problems about antibiotics. So about nosemosis, when the colony is really weak, and also in the part of this question, the last questions, we have some additives that are registered and we can we recommend them. Otherwise, they're quite hard regulatives, what you can put in the hives, because the hive is the production actually of food, and it comes after these rules. So it's very important that we have, like in Slovenia, we have Be Strong and Apiherb. I know that they are also in international market. What I can say is just that some beekeepers, especially when using Apiherb, they, with colonies that are weak, they are not doing well, they are not developing so good, they have quite good results. Otherwise, like Peter said, this was something we recommend, but something is wrong and the colonies are really not doing well. Otherwise, we know that bees are so strongly connected to the environment. And when the spring comes and the pollen comes and the nectar comes, everything goes better. So, and bees always find in the nature what they need. This is so, so, so important in a way of honeybee health. So bees will, if they have opportunity, they will find. About additives and food for colonies, additional food, actually the knowledge is not so good about it, what's really good and what's really not. Even if you look in the papers, you cannot get good information, exact information. So.
Thank you, Dr. Žvokelj. I would like to thank first all of the participants that posted their question, and also I would like to thank the three panelists for answering them all. It's good to hear that there are so many. The debate is ongoing, and we hope to continue this debate throughout the year through our series Save the Bees. I have shared in the chat a link to the YouTube channel of our embassy where this webinar will be posted in a couple of days. Ms. Ferfila has also shared a link to the YouTube video introduction of the Beekeeping Academy. Unfortunately, we do not have the possibility to see it due to technical reasons, but I'm certain that you can open it on your computers. Right, so in this case, I'm afraid that Madam Ambassador will not be able to join us. So again, many thanks to all your participants. I hope to see you in our next webinars. And again, grateful and many thanks to our panelists from Slovenia who were able to join their knowledge and expertise with us. So thank you all. And we will definitely inform you about our next events. So thank you and take care.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.